my name is James Tyberonn with Earthkeeper, and I'm here at the 12-12-12 conference with one of our keynote featured speakers, and that is author and researcher John Major Jenkins. Welcome, John.
Hey, James. It's so great to see you
it's
again.
It's great to see you, and it's an honor to have you here. And John, the New York Times talks about you as the most credible interpreter of the Mayan calendar, and we certainly agree with that. And you've spoken today to our conference here, and just some amazing interpretations and amazing information. And so just for this interview, I'd like to just ask you a few questions that I know we'll cover today, but right off the bat, what is going to happen on December 21st, 2012? That's the big question.
Well, as with all things in life, whatever happens depends on our own interaction with it, you know. Yeah. And I'm not trying to be evasive or anything like that. But, you know, there's several answers to that question. On a certain level, we can expect that the media and the culture at large is going to do what it usually does with something like this. And there are gala events planned, and the media will cover them. And 2012 has been interpreted through the filter of the doomsday thing.
Yeah.
So everything, I think, is going to be sort of reactionary to that. Is it going to be the end of the world? Is it not? You know? And to me, that's a bit unfortunate, you know, because 2012 is sort of treated as if it's synonymous with doomsday. And the thing is, though, that the Maya didn't really have a doomsday concept around this. You know, to them it was more about transformation and renewal and an opportunity for human beings to engage these amazing possibilities for awakening. And so again, people will have experiences depending on whether or not they're sort of closing down in fear, you know, like believing in all the doomsday rhetoric that's out there. And then unfortunately, people will have probably more limited experiences or even negative experiences if they succumb to fear. But if they open up in love to the great possibility of like opening up to the great mystery, then I think more positive results.
And so John, with 2012 and 2013 preceding being the new beginning in a real sense, what does the Mayan calendar, what is your opinion of what's next? What's going to unfold for us in 2013?
Well, I think a good thing is that we get past all the projections of shadows and misunderstandings, and so it becomes sort of a set piece.
Are there any Maya predictions that go into 2013?
Well, I don't know if they're predictions per se, but it's sort of like we get on with the process of, you know, creating the renewal, you know, and so the predictions are sort of about engaging the process of renewal, building a better world, certain values like community building and partnerships between people and organizations, and sort of putting it into practice.
Are there mentions in the Mayan information about the possible return after 2012 of gods, of extraterrestrials, of ancient aliens? Is there some sort of spoken consideration of a possible return of some sort?
Well, I don't see that as a literal return of you know, gods or ancient aliens or anything, but I think what that means sort of in a metaphorical way sense is that it is the time of the return of us having a more direct connection with our higher selves. So like the higher transcendent wisdom, you know, in the great cycles of time, things go through periods of increase and periods of decrease, and I think we're turning the corner. So now we're going to have a better opportunity to return to home, in a sense, like having a connection with that deep, you know, cosmic heart and source from which we all come.
Right. fascinating. Of all the, and you've been to all the Mayan locations, so many of the locations, which do you find the most fascinating, the most, the greatest energy? Which ones have had the greatest influence on you, that you feel like perhaps there's an existing stargate, power node, energy field?
All of the different Maya sites have real different personalities, you might say, different energies going on. And I tend to gravitate towards the ones that are, like Palenque, for example, is really a special site.
Yeah.
And it has sort of a mother goddess sort of energy to it.
Okay.
And, but in my work, I'm particularly biased to say that the early site of Izapa in southern Mexico, is a very, very special place. That's the site that I was drawn to in doing my reconstruction work, because it's the origin place of this 2012 calendar. And it does have a very, very nice feeling to it. It feels like it was an initiation center.
Really?
And yeah, like initiation into this.
Is this a pyramid site?
You know, there aren't any real large pyramids there.
Yeah.
So it's very special in that regard. And I think that it's, a lot of these sites are opening up again as initiation sites. So,
what is your impression? John Van Auken speaks a bit about, is it Mont Albon?
Monte Albon,
which means the White Mountain or the
something
along those lines.
Yeah.
Have you been there?
I have.
What is your impression that, for some reason, that particular location really has an intrigue for me? I've not been there yet, but there's something, I feel a call to go there, and I don't know why.
Oh,
I've been to Chichen Itza and some of the other ones, but that one.
I think of Monte Albán as being, well, it's situated on a high mountaintop,
uh-huh.
So you have to like take the road up there, and then you are on this open plateau. Mm-hmm. It's almost like the entire site is an altar to the skies.
Uh-huh.
So it's that kind of place where the connections between the dimensions are very open.
Yeah. You know, I had the opportunity at Chichen Itza a few years ago, before they roped it off, I had the ability to actually walk up to the top of the pyramid there, and then a rainstorm came, and so I had the gift of being trapped up there when no one else was coming during a lightning storm for about 3 hours, and had some remarkable experiences at the top up there.
Interesting.
Just an amazing place.
Well, the pyramids were built almost to be like altars to the sea.
Yeah.
You can go up on top and you feel that connection.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you, John, very much. And you have a website.
I do. My website, alignment2012.com, that's always been the portal into all the other websites that I have.
And how can people get your books?
Well, the books are available through the website.
Okay.
But go to any bookstore and you know, a lot of them are available.
John Major Jenkins, your newest book is?
Well, the latest book, I think of the 2012 story as sort of the latest book, but I also have booklets that I'm doing now that are available on my website.
Okay.
So
okay.
That's where to go for the booklets. Yeah.
Well, John, you're a fascinating academic. You have researched the topic, and I consider you, as does the New York Times, as does Shirley MacLaine, as does Oprah Winfrey, to be the foremost expert in this topic. And I think your contribution to humanity is enormous. And we honor the work that you do. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
You mean that.
Thank you.
Well, I'm going to take this jacket off, I think. Yeah. Is that okay? Wonderful. Does that work?
Thank you, John.
Okay. Above or below. I'll be careful. Okay. All right, that sounds good. What an amazing group of people. What a crowd. I'm always glad to be here. I'm very grateful for the invitation to return. I was here last year, and now here we are just days away from the great 13 Bakhtun cycle ending of the Maya long count calendar. And in fact, the 12th, 12, 12, 12, is a very special day in the Maya calendar tradition. It is the eight bats day of initiation that the traditional day keepers and spiritual guides of today down there in Guatemala, they're still doing their initiations. And so it's quite striking that this initiation day, which actually comes around every 260 days, so it falls on different times of the year, is happening to fall just 9 days before the great cycle ending. So I think there's some mysterious things going on here. Well, I'm glad and happy and, to share the work that I've done over about a 27-year period in my life, in this life anyway. I was asked by a friend several years ago how I first got involved in studying 2012 and the Maya cosmology. And I thought back and I thought, well, there was that, that first trip that I did, and then, well, before that, though, I remember that. And then you keep tracing it back, and you could go back like five lifetimes or something. But in this particular incarnation, there was a distinct moment when I was 12 years old. And I was sitting on the porch with my childhood friend, Joe. We had just been to the great bicentennial parade. It was 1976, and so bicentennial, 200 years, wow, like deep time. We started thinking about like deep time and then the dinosaurs, and they were a long time ago. And well, Joe told me that his dad was reading this book, and it was about these Indians down in Mexico who had this calendar, and it was going to end sometime in the near future. And later on that day, I was over at Joe's house, and his dad showed me this book. And a few years later, I had this deep sense of recognition. It was Frank Waters' book, Mexico Mystique. It came out in 1975. That's really the book that put this whole thing on the table. And so in some strange way, I was sort of initiated into this work at a young age. That was sort of like a seed that got planted. And then years later, I started doing my journeys to Central America, doing work with the Maya, and it led me deeper and deeper into these mysteries. So today I'm actually doing two presentations. So at 5 o'clock, I'm gonna have some surprises, some video clips and things like that, things that have been going on, and some real late breaking stuff. It's kind of amazing to me. It's like this year's been kind of strange. There's been these polarities, these extreme things going on, and I guess it's sort of like the challenge of how we integrate these extreme polarities. It can be very dislocating in some ways, but we have to sort of like, the only way you can sort of like reconcile the polarities is to go to a higher place and see them from a higher perspective. The place from which they're integrated. And it's not an easy thing if you're in the trenches with this stuff. And so this year's been pretty interesting, I guess, What is the old Chinese curse? May you be cursed to live in interesting times. And sometimes it is a curse, but it can also be a blessing, I guess. You know? So I will like to roll through this and present to you the work that I've been engaged in. And this is really sort of a tip of the iceberg sort of summary, because there's so many different facets of this now. And all right, so reconstructing what 2012 meant to the ancient Maya. That's what my concern has been. And, you know, it's funny. I go to, you know, the bookstores, and I look at the bookshelves, and, you know, they have different headings, you know, different categories for things. And, you know, people observe that, you know, my friend Jeff Stray, for example, in England, he's been tracking the whole 2012 phenomenon for many, many years, and he used to review everything that was coming out. You know, a book came out in 2012, he reviews it, and then a movie comes out, or a novel, or anything. He gave up on that like 8 years ago, because now there's over 2,000 things on 2012 in the marketplace, and there's over 1,000 books. It's quite amazing. It is a phenomenon, you know, and it has its own sort of meaning on these larger levels of how we as a culture relate to 2012, whatever it is that we're thinking it is, you know, projecting into it or believing it is. But the strange thing is that, oh, well, that was pretty strange. The strange thing is that you go to the bookstore, there's not a category for 2012. You know, it's not even in the current events section. It's weird. You know, the books on 2012 are strewn around in different places, mainly sort of like New Age or metaphysics or astrology or something like that. But it's not like a current event topic. It's not a Maya studies topic, you know. So I think it's, you know, it sort of represents like how 2012 has become sort of sticky paper for a lot of different things. This wide spectrum of the way it plugs into these different areas. And so it's been hard to categorize it, but I would suggest, you know, that probably first and foremost, the way that we should think about it is from the vantage point of what did the ancient Maya think about it? It seems self-evident, but it's not really something that's been embraced as far as I can tell. It is a true artifact of the ancient Maya calendar. So, you know, somehow I sort of just took it as obvious that, you know, that should be the approach to understanding 2012. So, you know, 20 years ago when I started diving into this mysterious 2012 date, I'd already been traveling around quite a bit, and I already had, you know, friends among the Maya, so I was sort of like connected into the Maya world anyway, but I was thinking that, yeah, this is a great mystery. What did the ancient Maya themselves think about this? And it had to be reconstructed because the long count calendar is a facet of the Maya tradition that fell into disuse, got fragmented. It's just the way things are, you know. Traditions die off, they stop being followed. Now the 260-day calendar, that is still followed by the traditional Maya, and I've been a great advocate of in support of that. But the long count that gives us the 2012 date stopped being carved in stone over 1,000 years ago. So the focus of my work has been astronomy, mythology, and spiritual teachings. And I try to honor the authentic Maya traditions as I try to give voice to these lost or fragmented aspects of the ancient Maya world. And that can be pursued in a fairly academic way, you know, interdisciplinary synthesis, a study based on primary sources, the Maya creation myth, the Popol Vuh, archaeoastronomy, you know, the way that buildings are lined up and indicate certain parts of the sky, like how the Maya thought about those parts of the sky, as well as the iconographic traditions, like how a ball court is represented, what does a ball court symbolize, you know, that kind of thing. But there's also this thing that goes beyond just a purely academic reconstruction, you know, because we start to tap into this deeper layer of knowledge. You know, the spiritual teachings go hand in hand with a more scientific, like science of astronomy or something like that. The Maya world, they saw these things as being integrated, so you can't deny one for the other or just focus on one half of the equation. And so when you integrate the spiritual viewpoint into these things, it becomes a deepening spiritual path. And that's the way I've experienced it in my own process. Like a deepening understanding of these universal metaphysical or spiritual principles that the Maya themselves had encoded into their traditions. So that's where it's not just sort of a scientific reconstruction, there's actual gnosis that's being uncovered. So one of the things that I'm most known for is my 2012 alignment theory, which involves the galactic alignment material as an explanation for why the Maya chose this date, 2012. And here's some of my books, going back, written many books over the years, and the breakthrough book really, I think, was Maya Cosmogenesis 2012, came out in 1998, and sort of put on the table the evidence for this galactic alignment theory, and then other books through the years. And, you know, when the internet, we have lived through a revolution, like an information revolution with the internet, and how possible it is to go out and do studies now, like with the information that's available. I mean, it's kind of a double-edged sword, you know, because, you know, in recent years, it seems like the internet has just become sort of a mess. You know, it's like a Rorschach test or something. You go out there and, or it's almost like an oracle or, a genie in a bottle. You can just pose a question on Google and, answers pop up or, you know. But then how do we discern, you know, what is real in all that? Becomes a difficult sort of thing. But going back to the early 90s, I was starting to integrate my research into various booklets that I was self-publishing, and then the Maya Cosmogenesis book was published. But in 1995, I started my website, alignment2012.com, and ever since then, it's grown into this huge resource of, 10,000 pages or something of research and information and links. And I've always, it's almost like the way that the Maya built their temples themselves. You know, they didn't destroy earlier layers of the temple like at Copan. The earliest little temple there from the second century AD is still there, and they just built over it. And then they built over the next one. That's sort of the way my website is. You know, there's like trap doors going down into a deeper level of the website, and you can get down into the very core sort of like pages that I uploaded in 1995. And the Maya Conservancy, we'll get into this a little bit, because it's a nonprofit that I helped co-found three, 4 years ago. And so we continue to work with the modern day Maya, and we do service projects, and we bring the Maya around to the different sites to do ceremony, because ceremony is very important in the Maya world. It's very, very important that they are able to do ceremony at the different sacred sites. Some sites are easier than others to get into, depending on the governmental policies in Guatemala versus Mexico or Honduras and these kinds of things. So we're trying to smooth the way and open up the doors so that the Maya can ritualistically reopen these energetic sites. They're like portals. And a lot of them have been glommed over with other types of energies from the archaeological digs and stuff like that, or they've just been closed down because ceremony hasn't happened there for centuries. So I think there's an amazing renaissance going on in the Maya world, and that work is going to continue beyond 2012. So the most recent book is the 2012 story, which kind of was a tell-all of all the various manifestations, all the different theories, and, you know, I think that a critical analysis is necessary for a lot of the ideas and theories that are put out there, you know, because, you know, unfortunately there's a lot out there that doesn't have anything to do with the Maya world, and, you know, the doomsday thing, for example. I mean, basically, this is one of the sad things, you know, that I've experienced, this increasing irrational superstorm around 2012, and now, you talk to any reporter or, you know, the media in general, if you say 2012, that's basically taken as being synonymous with doomsday. So it's kind of a real sad situation, because for many, many years, when I was, you know, studying the core traditions, like at the early Maya site called Izapa in southern Mexico, this is the place that's responsible for the formulation of the long count. So it's going to tell us something about the core revelation, the primary ideas that the people who created this 2012 calendar came up with. And there's carved monuments, there's alignments to, you know, parts of the sky, and everything there screams out that they thought of 2012 as a time of transformation and renewal, not some kind of apocalyptic doomsday. So the 2012 story exposes a lot of these fallacies in the marketplace, and I also summarize, you know, the latest breakthroughs, you know, like the 2012 inscription from the site of Tortuguero. This only came to widespread attention about 6 years ago. It's amazing. I got some slides on this I'm going to share with you. And then just this year, another inscription with the 2012 date on it was found from a site called La Corona in Guatemala. And all these incredible breakthroughs are happening. And so, you know, it's almost like there's this malaise around the 2012 date, though. I mean, I don't know, maybe I'm too close to it or something like that, but that's sort of what I've experienced. Like, after the 2012 Doomsday movie came out in 2009, Roland Emmerich's movie, I was actually invited to do the press conference stuff for that and go on the red carpet and talk to the media and stuff like that. And I thought, all right, well, this is going to be like, you know, spitting into the wind or something like that. But I'm gonna try to give them the goods on this. But ever since then, it's just been sort of like a topic frozen in time or something. Everybody's kind of sick of it now or something. But anyway, so there's many different things like that. But I'll read a little excerpt here from the 2012 story. Into the blue, dreaming of clouds in Washaktun, angels grab my eye. Peaceful stones transcend my reason. A shadowless noon in the midsummer season defines this location as wise. Tropical moss enshrouds old stone, forgotten town decays. Soul sparks long in tireless flight arrive alone on a moonless night upon the backs of stellar rays. Time and fate will wait for you to find eternal rest when the world dissolves away into the blue of a dimming day. Just watch it all unmanifest. So that might be a bit of a surprise, but this book begins and ends with poetry. Poetry has always been a central concern of mine, and poetry, in a sense, gets us closer to the sources of wisdom, I think, than discursive study. I want to share something with you that blew my mind. And I feel like I'm kind of, you know, well-versed in these different things. But they're discovering a lot of new sites in the Peitain Wilderness and in Guatemala. There's a place called El Mirador that has this huge pyramid. And it's kind of hard to see here, but this image shows the El Dante complex from El Mirador overlaid. It's kind of transparent. It's like overlaid over these other buildings. And that entire thing that it overlays is the central complex of Tikal. If you've ever been to Tikal, you know that this is a huge space. And so for the El Dante complex to be encapsulating that entire space is just mind-blowing. There's more stone in this pyramid than in the Great Pyramid at Cheops. And the basic structure here is not even the entire man-made thing. I mean, it's on a man-made platform surrounded by even, you know, little temples around the edges. And here's a realistic portrait that the archaeologists reconstructed at the site of El Mirador, which was a huge metropolis even before the Maya Classic period began, which is like 200 AD to 900 AD. So we're pushing back the fringes, you know, of this incredibly advanced civilization. Here's a realistic portrait of the entire site. And that complex is way off there in the distance, and all these buildings are, you know, built up from you know, the picture is based on the remains. And so we're talking about a huge metropolis there in the northern part of Guatemala some 2,000 years ago. Okay, I have little snippet segments here just because I like to share some of the core things with my research that, you know, some of this I think is sort of flown under the radar, or it sort of magically gets incorporated into other people's books or something like that. But I wrote about this in Maya Cosmogenesis 2012. It's a reconstruction that is totally unprecedented, but it's based upon evidence for how the Maya thought about the zenith of the sky. The Maya were interested in the idea of the cosmic center, you know, because they believed that they should be correctly oriented to the cosmic center, you know, like as above, so below. And so the sky actually presents several different options for the cosmic center. You know, there's the pole star in the northern sky around which the Big Dipper revolves. It seems like it's a center because all the stars are revolving around it. And then there's also, like, within the tropical zone in Mesoamerica, the sun can reach the exact, you know, in its yearly advance through the sky, it can reach the zenith, the exact center of the sky overhead. And it does so on 2 days every year. But the precise day depends on your latitude. So Chichen Itza has a very special latitude for the solar zenith passage day. And because of this, I noticed that there was something unrecognized about the pyramid of Kukulcan at Chichen Itza, Kukulcan being Quetzalcoatl, the plumed serpent. And I'm sure you all know about this, the shadow serpent that appears every equinox. Many of you probably have gone and seen it. And basically what happens is that late in the day, in the late afternoon of every equinox, the sun casts a shadow on the northern balustrade of the stairway of the pyramid, and it kind of has the appearance of an undulating snake with the head at the bottom. We know the head should be at the bottom because there's actually a carved stone serpent head there. And I always wondered, it seems kind of strange because where's the tail? There should be a tail here because you see these inverted serpent columns all over Chichen Itza, like this one here. Here's the inverted serpent column with the rattle of the serpent up above. And you even have these like serpent wands that the kings would hold, and they have a head at the bottom, and then there's this deity where the tail should be. Well, Jose Diaz Bolio was a Yucatec Maya researcher, and he pointed out that the king snakes in Yucatan, they have the rattle, but they also have this strange little three-dot motif which represents the sun face. So you have the sun symbol and the rattle symbol. And the interesting connection here, and this was sort of the key that led me into the deeper sort of like interpretation of this, is that in the Yucatec Maya language, the word for the Pleiades is tsab, and that's the same word for the rattle. So the Pleiades, they're the rattle constellation. Now, because of this, it then seemed to me that, well, this inverted serpent column thing and the shadow serpent, where's the tail? Maybe it was indicating something unusual. And so if we were looking straight down on the pyramid from above, we have the four corners and the central direction. This is the famous quincunx symbol of the Maya. It represents a space and time sort of cosmogram idea where the four directions are like the four world ages, and then the fifth direction or the fifth world age is in the center. That's the zenith. It represents the zenith. And if we were looking at this pyramid from above, that's the image you get. And so we could imagine the tail of the serpent going right up through the center, pointing into the zenith of the sky. And so it's sort of telling us in the iconography that there will be an alignment of the sun and the Pleiades in the zenith. That seems to be what it's saying. And there's a whole set of other arguments. I'm not going to go into it, but now, the thing about this is that, you know, the sky is very complex. Things come into alignment over long periods of time. In fact, there's this phenomenon called the precession of the equinoxes, which causes these different things to shift and to come into resonance at different times during this large 26,000-year precessional cycle. And it's a fact of astronomy that these things don't come together over the latitude of Chichen Itza until the 21st century. this century. The sun and the Pleiades aligning in the zenith over Chichen Itza, which is, seems to be what this is pointing to, a rare era of cosmic alignment, doesn't happen until our century. And if you look at the symbolism of this, then this would be like the legendary return of Quetzalcoatl. After all, this is the pyramid of Kukulcan, Quetzalcoatl. And so this visible shadow serpent that appears every equinox seems to be harboring a deeper esoteric mystery that is in fact invisible or must be inferred or extrapolated from the evidence. And that's the way the Maya world sort of worked, with its deep sort of profound mysticism and metaphysical illusions. And so this is mind-blowing, because what it means is the Pyramid of Kukulcan is like a processional star clock in stone. You know, like back in the 90s, Robert Bovall reconstructed these stellar alignments with the so-called air shafts in the Great Pyramid. And that, you know, back calculating the calculations and the processional shifting, he was able to, you know, nail a certain time, you know, many thousands of years ago when the stars aligned with the air shaft. And so the Great Pyramid at Egypt is a processional star clock in stone. And in this way, as I've reconstructed it, so is the Pyramid of Kukulcan at Chichen Itza. Now, if that wasn't enough, I also noticed that, okay, yeah, you could be standing there looking at the shadow serpent coming down. It's about 4:30 p.m. on the equinox. And you can turn around and walk about 100 yards over that way, and you'll be standing in the middle of the Great Ball Court at Chichen Itza. Now, notice how high the walls are. They're very, very high. They're not even slanted. So as a place where the ball game might actually be played, it's sort of useless. Well, on a certain level, that's okay, because the ball game was more like a mystery play. It wasn't necessarily intended to be a demonstration of athletic prowess or something like that. I mean, some of the ball courts were, and the ball game certainly can be played like that. But in some of these spaces, it was more like the place where the performance of the mystery play of the creation myth with the hero twins, and they're battling the dark lords, and they're trying to resurrect their father in the ball court. It was like a great performance that all the people would come around and watch, you know, and they could plug into the symbolism of the performance of the mystery play at whatever level they could, because it had real meaning at different levels of the culture. But anyway, this is pretty amazing, because notice that, you know, the walls are so high, and the archaeologists, they always were wondering why the walls are so high on this great pyramid, ball court. I think the reason why is so that at this precise moment that the shadow serpent is appearing over here, the sun is also casting a shadow that is splitting the lengthwise axis of the ball court directly in half, with half in darkness and half in light. And that's, of course, exactly what an equinox is, right? It's the day of equal day and night. So, of course, it could just be a huge coincidence, right? That's what I'm always told when I present these things to the scholars. Unless they discover it first, and then it's true. Yeah. Well, I extrapolated that out, and actually I wrote about this eclipse that happened this year, 16 years ago. And so there's this eclipse that involves not only the sun in alignment with the Pleiades, which at the latitude of Chichen Itza is in the zenith, but not at other places like in the northern hemisphere. But anyway, it's interesting that on that same date, a solar eclipse occurred. And so I had the great good fortune to be invited out to Nevada to witness this at the Symbiosis Gathering. And it was quite striking. So these teachings of the Maya, you know, we encounter this really profound worldview. It's a holistic worldview. I've talked about it in different terms, like a non-dual philosophy, like you find in the Vedanta tradition or many of the traditions of Oriental mysticism. It's a transcendence of a duality. It's a recognition that these apparently mutually exclusive opposites, you know, are actually integrated on another level. You know, they're like two sides of the same coin. And you see this quite beautifully in this plaque, where you have the enfleshed face on the right and the skull face on the left. It's a statement saying that they recognize that life and death go together and are one. I believe that this non-dual vision of reality, which I think actually is a deep insight into the nature of reality, comes from the shamanic traditions of Mesoamerica. Maya civilization was shamanistic, and shamanism played a very, very important role in the formulation of these different ideas about time and consciousness and ritual and how time and space are interrelated. And there's a lot of evidence, actually, that the Mesoamerican people were using things like mushrooms and DMT, which is the dimethyltryptamine harvested from the toad secretions. And in fact, as we'll see, Izapa is sort of the core place of my reconstruction work. It's the place that really was the focus of my reconstruction. It's the origin place of the Long Count 2012 calendar. And there's a lot of evidence that the sky watchers there were using these substances, and that could explain how such a profound integrative multidimensional paradigm was encoded into this Long Count 2012 calendar. As a sort of a illustration of how this multidimensional sort of paradigm works, we could just look at the 260-day calendar, which is the Dzogchen. It's the core building block of the Maya time systems. It's made up of 20-day signs, sequentially combined with a number from 1 to 13, so 13 times 20 is 260. Well, the Maya of today offers an explanation for this 260-day sacred number, is that it corresponds to the 9-month period of human gestation. It's like representative of that first great cycle of unfolding that we all share as human beings. That first cycle of individual unfolding. In fact, Maya midwives use it, you know, to calculate the birthday. And, okay, well, that's cool. That operates on the level of human biology, you might say. But the Dzogchen is also used, it's the interval between the planting and harvesting of corn in the highlands of Guatemala. Well, that's pretty neat because that's like an agricultural cycle. So that's like an earth rhythm. So they're connecting up this human biological rhythm with this earth rhythm. And it works nicely because in the mythology, human beings are made from corn dough. So it's the corn and the human beings and the formation of the body and so on. It's all sort of nicely integrated there. But most incredibly, the 260-day Dzogchen calendar is used as a key in those almanacs that you find in like the Dresden Codex or the Madrid Codex that calculate they're used to predict the like eclipses and the Mars cycle and the moon cycle and all these astronomical things. So that's the astronomical component of this. And you can see that the 260-day calendar is like the key that operates on these different domains of human experience. It's like the multidimensional key that, it's basically that as above, so below principle. The processes in the sky reflect the processes on the earth, reflect the processes of human unfolding. So the Long Count calendar is found carved on many different monuments, and you know, there's beliefs about time and the creation of the world and cosmology. And the Long Count is this mathematical system that's built up period of days. The key thing here that I just want to illustrate is that there is this 13 Bakhtun cycle in the Long Count. It's 5,125 years. And scholars have, you know, haggled over how the Maya calendar relates to our own calendar, but it's been figured out. This is one of those great misunderstandings in the marketplace today. There's this cottage industry and people, no, the end date's not December 21st of 2012, it's some other date. And so everybody's got their little niche, and these arguments just don't work. You know, you have to look at the full interdisciplinary set of information. And when you do that, you find that there's only one correlation of the Maya calendar with our own that really works with the astronomy, with the carbon 14 dating, with the historical documents, with the survival of the 260-day calendar today in the highlands of Guatemala. That's an unbroken survival going back 3,000 years. That provides the key. That's like the litmus test for any correlation proposition. And it's the one that confirms that the great cycle ending falls on December 21st of 2012. And that's a solstice. That was the key for me over 20 years ago when I started researching this. It's like, oh, the cycle ending falls on a solstice. Could that just be a coincidence? Well, maybe, maybe not. So I started investigating, and it led me into the work that I've done. What I found, in a nutshell here, is that I found evidence that the 2012 end date of the long count was intended to target a rare alignment in this great cycle of the precession of the equinoxes. It is the alignment, as viewed from Earth, of the December solstice sun coming into alignment with the great band of the Milky Way galaxy. This can be called a galactic alignment or solstice galaxy alignment. It's been known about, I tracked, you know, it's an astronomical fact, so it's basically implied in the 1950 Star Atlas data, but it doesn't seem to have been really recognized until the great book Hamlet's Mill, written by science historians Giorgio De Santayana and Hertha von Dechand, came out in 1969. And then the visionary philosopher Terence McKenna, having read Hamlet's Mill, mentioned it in the book that he co-wrote with his brother Dennis, 1975, called The Invisible Landscape. And then astrologers were talking about it in the 80s and so on. What I contributed to this is that I showed how the galactic alignment, the features involved in the galactic alignment, are encoded into these core Maya institutions like the ball game and the creation myth and the monuments of Zappa. And then beyond that, there's been just a succession of new evidence that's come in for this. So the galactic alignment is caused by the slow wobbling of the Earth on its axis, the precession of the equinoxes. Here it is. A couple of features should be pointed out here. Of course, you can see the Milky Way. And then this horizontal dotted line is the ecliptic. That's the path followed by the sun, moon, and planets. It's where the 12 signs of the zodiac are located. Notice that there's a cross formed by the Milky Way and the ecliptic. That is the great cross, or the sacred tree of the Maya. And it's almost like an X marks the spot that the cross actually, strangely enough, targets this nuclear bulge area where the galactic center is located. And there's this other feature that's caused by interstellar dust. It's called the dark rift, or the great cleft. And the Maya mythologized this as the Xibalba Bay, the road to the underworld. And there's a whole complex of meanings. It's not just that. I mean, the Maya mythologized these astronomical features in many different ways. So it depends on how you're thinking about it. There's different frameworks that you can plug into. If the Milky Way was seen to be the cosmic snake or the cosmic monster, then the dark rift is its mouth. If it's seen to be the great ball court, then the dark rift is like the goal ring in the ball court. If the Milky Way is seen to be the great cosmic mother, then the galactic center nuclear bulge is her womb, and the dark rift is her birth canal. And these are the key ways that the Maya were thinking about this this astronomy. So we'll get back into that in a minute, but the galactic alignment is shown here with these different positions of the December solstice sun through time. So say some 6,000 years ago, the December solstice sun was positioned here in the sky, quite far from the galactic center dark rift area. And then some 3,000 years ago, it's here. It's shifting closer. Precession is causing the position of the sun on the solstice to shift along the ecliptic very slowly. I believe the ancient Maya sky watchers, they noticed this convergence process, similar to how the Greek astronomer Hipparchus noticed the precessional shifting in the second century BC, and he wasn't using telescopes. But you know, you can just notice it because of the different rise times of the stars. But for the Maya, it held great meaning because they noticed that there was this convergence going on between the sun and the Milky Way. And they mythologized it as the future joining of like the cosmic father, the cosmic solar father deity with the cosmic Milky Way mother deity. And they projected forward. Then they wanted to calculate when it was going to occur. And that was the great sort of scientific challenge that the early people of Mesoamerica had to grapple with. And I believe they achieved it, and they embedded it into their long count calendar, and it gives us the December 21st, 2012 date. So that's the galactic alignment. You know, it's not exactly rocket science. There is this, if you want to be really precise about it, there is this thing called the galactic equator. That's the red line I just brought up there. Runs right along the lateral midline of the Milky Way. And, you know, so astronomers have calculated this. You know, the thing to illustrate here is that it's such a slow process. You know, like the body of the sun itself is half a degree wide, so it's going to take the body of the sun some 36 years to process through the precise midline of the galactic equator. So, you know, just, you can't really nail it down to a specific day or a specific year, but the Maya had to pick a specific day and a specific year within a range of their calculations. So they actually were very, very accurate in their calculations. This is something I'll get into in a little bit. Lady Cabell is a Maya ruler. She was designated Calomte, which is a very powerful ruler. And these women rulers, they often wore as a belt ornament these spondylus shells. And it's known that they represented the generative organs. And so also Maya rulers, whether they're male or female, they represent sort of the vertical pillar of the cosmos, like the tree or the axis mundi. You know, they were shamanistic, so they had to mediate the shamanistic domains from the underworld to the earth world of human beings to the celestial world. So one of the axis mundi symbols is the Milky Way, like the sacred tree, the Milky Way. So to me, this carving of Lady Cabell shows that she is sort of representing the Milky Way goddess, and that, you know, her womb is a very, very important part of this. This sort of just goes to one of the things I put on the table many years ago is that the Milky Way was mythologized as a goddess, and the galactic center was like the womb of the goddess. So that's just to underscore how we can think about the galactic alignment as the solar deity coming into alignment with the womb of the great mother goddess. It gives rise to the ideas of a regeneration or a rebirth. You know, a coming back into intimate relationship with the cosmic heart and source and womb of creation. So I'm not going to go into this a lot, but I do have to sort of dispel some of the craziness around the galactic alignment, because it's very strange. The NASA astronomers apparently don't believe it's real. You know, there's this, you know, dismissing of it because they say, oh, well, it doesn't happen precisely on December 21st of 2012. Well, yeah, so what? You know, the question is, did the ancient Maya calculate it? Where's the evidence for that? I have, you know, many books that pile up the evidence for that. But there's these different ideas that critics kind of project onto it, or that it isn't really about. Like, even the great visionary philosopher Jose Arguelles, in his book The Mayan Factor, he talks about galactic synchronization. But if you read the intro to that and his discussion of the galactic synchronization in that book, it's not talking about the galactic alignment. He's talking about these photon beams that come into play, and it's, you know, it's a very generalized sort of mystical concept. And then other critics dismiss it because they say, oh, the galactic alignment, it's just astrology. You know? Well, maybe the Maya thought about it in some kind of astrological way, but that doesn't deny the factual astronomical basis of it. So you get these scholarly debunker priests like John Hoops and others in academia who just, they'll use these loaded terms like pseudoscience or astrology, and it's like they're failing to do their jobs. They're not even engaging with the information in any kind of real way. So the key thing here is that it's fascinating and amazing how the galactic alignment astronomy is embedded into the Maya traditions. And it seems like it's involved in deity birthdays and Maya kings and their birthdays as well. Like, for example, the great Temple of the Cross plaque from Palenque here shows the son of Pakal Votan. His name's Khan Balam. And it's actually showing Khan Balam at two different ages in his life. The little guy on the left is Khan Balam at age 7, and then Khan Balam becoming king at age 49 on the right. But the point is that, you know, there's these rituals around the sacred tree, and he's sort of like deriving his power in the text by stating that he has a relation to this deity named God One, who's one of the Palenque triad deities. And this is God One here at the bottom. This is his face. And he's sort of like rooted. He's like the god at the root of the sacred Milky Way tree. and he's a solar deity. And then these are like planetary, you know, symbols here. That's the ecliptic. So right away we see that part of the sky where the galactic alignment occurs. And the sun is placed right at that crossroads of the Milky Way and the ecliptic. So that's pretty cool. In the text, we actually have this god's birthday. He was born on November 8th of 2360 BC. It's the supernatural. Why'd they choose that day? Well, let's look at the astronomy for that day. Oh, what do you know? Oh my gosh, the sun is actually right at the crossroads of the Milky Way and the ecliptic on that day. What a coincidence. Now, the important thing to notice here, or to realize here, is that obviously this image of the sun at the crossroads is evocative of the 2012 alignment, right? The 2012 alignment happens on the solstice. Precession has brought the solstice into alignment with this thing that happens. Back then in 2360 BC, yeah, you have a date when the sun lines up at the crossroads, but it's not the solstice. It's actually 61 days before the solstice, way back then. Because precession then will slowly bring the solstice into alignment with that thing. Well, that's not a problem. That just, you know, it helps us understand how the Maya themselves were looking at different dates, at different eras when the sun lined up with this crossroads place, and how they then mythologized it and talked about it in their narratives as like the birthday of the deity. And then the Maya king, Khan Balam, he'd draw his like supernatural power for rulership by associating himself with this deity. It helps us understand that the galactic alignment was something real and something that the Maya were working with on many different levels. Now, Lord Jaguar, this is very recent stuff, and by 2006, I'd been doing research and writing for, you know, 16, 17 years and traveling to Mesoamerica and so on. And the 2012 alignment theory was out there. My Cosmogenesis came out in 1998. And in 2006, it was announced that there was this date on this monument from a site called Tortuguero, Monument 6. You know, some of the specialists had known about it for many years, but they weren't fessing up. You know, they weren't trying to contribute anything to the conversation. In fact, they were probably trying to keep it away because it actually provides evidence for the galactic alignment theory. There was a king named Lord Jaguar, and he was a contemporary of the great Pakal Votan, or Hanab Pakal, from Palenque. The two places, Tortuguero and Palenque, are only about 35 miles apart. And there's a really, really interesting, amazing story here, but I'm just going to give you the surface details. I was able to go look at this monument in 2011. I went there with a film crew, and it ended up being integrated into a film documentary called 2012 The Beginning, which just came out this year, which is a great documentary film about 2012. I was able to examine the Tortuguero Monument 6 text up close. And there's actually 13 dates on the monument. The first date is Lord Jaguar's birthday. The last and 13th date is the 2012 date. So notice that they're sort of in structural parallel on the two flanges of the T-shaped monument. And let's take a closer look at the 2012 date. That's the right flange. And you see the 13 baktuns here, the two bars and the three dots, that equals 13. 13 baktuns, and then it's 4 ahau in the Dzogchen calendar and 3 kankin in the 365-day Hob calendar. That's just the way that they've portrayed the date. And then there's something that says that there's a ceremony with a deity named Bolon Yokte that's going to occur. Bolon Yokte is the deity then that's associated with this 2012 date, and Maya scholars recently have deciphered it. There was initially some rough decipherment put out by David Stewart, which has been proven to be inaccurate. He's the one who said that it's the descent of the Bolon Yokte deity, but it's not a descent. It's a wrapping or adorning of that deity. And this makes perfect sense. There's going to be a witnessing or a supervising of this ceremony, and the deity will be wrapped. This is a typical ceremonial process that the Maya would do, where they would adorn and wrap a deity in preparation for its sacrifice. This idea of sacrifice or surrender, or surrendering of this image, so that the world could move on and be renewed. It's like a ceremonial equation that deity sacrifice is necessary for world renewal. In the creation myth, it's the sacrifice of the vain and false ruler named Seven Macaw. Seven Macaw is the deity that appears at the end of the cycle. He's squawking loudly and he's magnifying himself and he's deceiving humanity. He's the archetype of vain, megalomaniacal egoism. And the Hero Twins actually have to put him back in his proper place. You know, it's a metaphor. It's not like tearing hearts out or something. And so this is the spiritual teaching, basically, for a cycle ending like 2012, is that the false deity or our false illusions must be sacrificed or surrendered so that we can move into a place of renewal and rebirth. That's the ceremonial process and the ceremonial equation that is being alluded to here with the Bolognocte deity. There was a more sort of technical aspect of my visit to the Tortuguero Monument in 2011. We had to confirm Lord Jaguar's birthday. There's these distance numbers, and you sequentially move through the text through the many different dates, and the distance numbers help you calculate the next date or the previous date. And unfortunately, there was this broken part, but I was able to get a close-up view of it, and I was able to confirm that Lord Jaguar's birthday is November 28th of 612 AD. So let's look at the astronomy for that date. Oh, what do you know? Incredible, the sun is right at the crossroads of the Milky Way and the ecliptic, just like God One's birthday on the Palenque Temple of the Cross tablet. Now, again, this isn't happening on the solstice because Lord Jaguar was born 1,400 years ago. So this is actually happening about 20 days before the solstice, whereas God One's birthday in 2360 BC happened some 61 days before the solstice. Notice it's sort of like coming closer and closer together. So the question then becomes, oh, well, this is very interesting. Lord Jaguar apparently wanted to associate himself with the future 2012 period ending because there was a parallel between his birthday astronomy and the 2012 astronomy. Again, it's kind of like what Pakal's son, Khan Balam, did. He wanted to associate himself with this sort of diagnostic astronomical configuration to sort of boost his power and status and show that he actually had the divine right to rule and so on. Now, with these two images here, I've actually removed the daylight. You can see the sun at the crossroads of the Milky Way and the ecliptic. The top one is Lord Jaguar's birthday, and the bottom one is the 2012 cycle ending date. So, you know, this sort of just starts becoming boring or something like that. Because I could go through and show you like five or six other examples from other texts. But this is the stuff that's completely ignored by the scholars and the media. You know, what was it, like 3 years ago I did an interview with ABC Nightline. They brought me to New York City. And I already had all this stuff in place. I'd given a presentation at the Society for American Archaeology, which was one of the rare occasions when I had a supportive scholar invite me in to do something at an academic institution. But, and I laid it all out, you know, in concise terms in about, you know, five sentences. That didn't make it into the ABC Nightline program. So it's kind of strange, you know. This is stuff, yeah, certainly it verifies the reconstruction work that I've done and offered, you know, many years ago, and that's cool, you know, I'm glad there's new evidence for it, but we should also just look at this, what this means. I mean, the Maya were incredibly sophisticated astronomically, and they were doing this amazing, amazing thing. On a more metaphysical or ritualistic level, it's very fascinating. It's like cooler than the best sci-fi stories I've read. Lord Jaguar apparently was interested in showing his divine connection with these big cycles in the creation myth, And he did it through his birthday astronomy in parallel to the galactic alignment astronomy in 2012. Now, I'll share with you this other, I talked about it in my Lord Jaguar booklet. I'm not going to do any readings from there. We probably don't have time. Maybe in the 5 o'clock talk, I'll do a little readings from Lord Jaguar's 2012 inscriptions. But I'll share with you something really, really cool. Okay, remember how I said that Bolon Yokte is like, he's sort of the god of the underworld. He's sort of like the chief of the Dark Lords, like sort of like Seven Macaw in the creation myth. And that deity must be sacrificed in order to ensure world renewal into the next cycle. That's part of the ritual process. Well, part of that text says that it will be supervised. The adorning and wrapping of Bolon Yokte will be supervised and witnessed. By who? Well, the epigraphers, the academic epigraphers, Barb McLeod and Sven Gronmeier, they themselves acknowledge that there seems to be this referential sort of way that the narrative's set up such that it's Lord Jaguar who will be there in 2012 to do the ceremony or witness the ceremony. I actually believe that Lord Jaguar wrote this text and he's stating that he will reappear on December 21st of 2012 to perform the ceremonial sacrifice of Bolon Yokte. Because there's another text from Tortuguero where he's being given the status of a sacrificial priest, and that seems to be the setup so that now he's got that merit badge and then he can actually do the ceremonial sacrifice thing. Now that's pretty bizarre. Like how could, what a very amazing sort of rhetorical propaganda statement that would be for a king to be able to say that. And then of course, well, how's it even possible? I mean, the guy died 1400 years ago. Well, let's think about it. In many of the Maya inscriptions, you see these texts where a Maya king invokes a departed ancestor king to be present for some ceremony that's taking place in the contemporary time. Now, if they can do it that way, they could also do it the other way into the future, right? So the concept that a departed king could be invoked for something long after he's dead is already present in the Maya tradition. It's just that Lord Jaguar sort of set himself up to be the departed king that would be invoked in 2012 to perform the sacrifice of the god of illusion, otherwise known as Wall Street. So, did I say that? I'm sorry about that. Well, actually, in my book, The 2012 Story, I actually made that connection. In terms of like, there's all this talk about what is the Maya prophecy, you know, well, there's a lot of mistaken notions about what the Maya prophecy is, but the main, you know, true nugget in that is that, yeah, the Maya expected that at the end of the cycle, Seven Macaw, or self-serving egoism and self-interest and greed, would be the archetype or the energy that would be pervading the planet and ruling and ruining the world. And so in the 2012 story, I actually go into this in several chapters talking about modern politics and the corporate structure of the world and how it is not oriented towards having an acknowledgement of the interdependence of all things, which again is that non-dual philosophy that the Maya and many Oriental, you know, cultures embrace, you know, take as a truism about the nature of reality. And so it sort of strikes to the heart of like how we have to think about revisioning our world and how we do business on the planet, and that we do need to surrender our attachment to this illusion that you know, greed is good and that's the way things should be, which is unfortunately the way that, you know, things really are in the global culture right now. Anyway, that's a whole other story, but I want to get to these other things too. Well, yeah, believe it or not, there was another 2012 inscription found this year. And it's from a place called La Corona. Here is the text. Unfortunately, the upper left part is broken off. It's very possible that this upper left part contains the birthday of the king who commissioned this monument, sort of like the way that Lord Jaguar commissioned that other one. Because the birthday was sort of the key to the narrative and why the king would want to relate himself to the 2012 date. Some kind of special circumstance of the birthday astronomy that could be argued or asserted or used in the rhetoric of the narrative to connect him to 2012. Well, in the lower left or lower right, we have the 2012 date, the four how, three can keen. And actually here you have the 13, but it's not 13 baktuns, it's 13 katuns, which is another part of the long count calendar. It's referring to another date actually, but it's used in a way because this king, his name is Yuknum, he is calling himself the 13 Khatun King because this date of the 13 Khatun is a special key date that links his birthday to 2012, and this is the way it works. There actually is this other monument where we get his birthday from. So we know his birthday is October 4th of 649, and on that day you had the moon and Saturn conjunct in Gemini. Kind of interesting that Castor and Pollux and Gemini sort of point right to the alignment. It's not at the crossroads. That's his birthday in 649, but this 13 Khatun date that happened, you know, when he was 43 years old in the year 692 AD, which is the date that he sort of cites on the text, this 13 Khatun date also has the moon and Saturn conjunct, and this time it's right at the crossroads. And they were so close that on that evening, the moon, as it's slowly shifting, actually occulted or moved right over Saturn. It was that close. Very, very key date. And this is the date, then, I think, that is used to link up to the sun's position at the crossroads in 2012. So Yuknum was doing something very similar to what Lord Jaguar was doing in using his birthday astronomy. So the two 2012 dates affirm the astronomy of the galactic alignment that I first identified at Azapa in the mid-1990s. It also echoes the sacrifice and renewal theme of the spiritual teachings I identified in the creation myth at Azapa, which is work that I did in the early mid-1990s and was published in my Cosmogenesis 2012. So I could go into these other things. I have these, you know, responses to the Planet X thing, and maybe if there's questions, I could talk more about that. But just to be sort of proactively moving it forward, Lady Kabel was the daughter of Yuknum. This is the powerful female ruler that I mentioned earlier, where her belly is like the galactic center. She's the daughter of Yuknum, and she also was using this 13 Khatun date on this carving, and it's quite astounding because you start to uncover this whole tradition that was using these kinds of galactic alignments as you know, connecting points in the narrative. So, shifting now to Azapa. I mean, this is sort of like, let's take a deep breath, because Azapa really is a key. And the reason why I keep coming back to this, and maybe this seems like a rerun to some of you if you've seen some of my previous programs, is because, you know, I still don't see that Azapa is really incorporated into the discussion that well. You know, I've done lots of documentary interviews, and I've gone, you know, to different places and talked about this work. Azapa was like an initiatory center. It's the origin place of the long count and the 2012 paradigm. It's the place where the early creation myth is found, the Maya creation myth, the Popol Vuh with the hero twins, and the seven macaw bird deity here on his polar perch. Seven macaw represents the Big Dipper constellation. There's the hero twins facilitating the demise of seven macaw. He's falling from his perch. Ego has to be put back in its proper place. Here's the great myth portrayed on Stela 25, which is in the museum by Azapa. With the hero twin, One of the hero twins is looking up into the tree of where seven macaws perched. And here's the cosmic alligator, who represents the Milky Way with its head at the bottom, which is the nuclear balls of the galactic center, and seven macaws up here on his polar perch. So you have like two cosmic centers going on here, like the polar center and the galactic center. And there's two deities associated with these two centers, which is basically the seven macaw deity and then the father of the hero twins. So there's these two types of consciousness that are sort of battling for supremacy, you might say, or to be the recognized. The Tree of Life carving from Azapa is quite amazing. The archaeologist Garth Norman has explored this in great detail. Here is one of the carvings from Azapa that represent the DMT toad. It shows that the shaman in the boat is traveling into the maw of the toad deity, which is like the shamanic journey into the underworld, right? But there's also these vision scrolls coming out of the shoulder glands of this frog deity. And that's where the dimethyltryptamine is harvested and is used in sacred medicines like ayahuasca and things like that. But for many of the shamans, it was merely smoked instead of being prepared as a something to be drunk. And then there's also mushroom stones found all over the area. So there was a great deal of visionary cosmologizing going on at the site of Azapa. But the key place at the site is the ball court. This is like ground zero of the 2012 prophecy, the origin of the 2012 cosmology. Notice the ball court here, and archaeologists have put these sheds over the monuments to protect them from further erosion. On the far end here, you see this throne, close up here. The throne has a head on the front of it, and it's broken, but here's like a solar god head, and it's coming out, it's being born from between these two legs, but the feet are broken off. So it's like a birthing image. Well, it's not that surprising, because any king that sat on a throne, he was like a symbolic birther. You know, a Maya king was like a shaman, a high shaman, and he had to commune with the cosmic center and the, you know, celestial transcendent energy and wisdom, and he had to sort of like download into, you know, the local kingdom these energies. You know, so he was like birthing the higher dimensional frequencies into the world. So it's not surprising to see a birth image on a throne. If you sat on the throne, you'd look out over the lengthwise axis, to, you know, of the ball court to this horizon over here. And what's going on over that horizon? The December solstice sunrise. The ball court is lined up with the horizon position of the sun rising on the solstice. To me, this was a key because it's about solar rebirth. The ball game itself is about solar rebirth. But the ball court here is telling the story of the future convergence and rebirth of the world when the December solstice sun lines up with the galactic center. So if you were a sky watcher, you know, like there are these six seating stones behind the throne, and if, so it indicates that people were sitting here looking out over the ball court to this horizon. And if you were sitting there before the sun rose on the solstice, on any particular solstice, you know, between 400 BC and 100 AD or something, that's when Azapa was in its heyday, you would observe the Milky Way rising before the sun rose on the solstice. So there would be a separation or a distance between the two. But then if you were a sky watcher, and we know that there were people living at Azapa since 1500 BC, so we have like over 1,000 years of observational possibilities here, they would notice that these two things were converging. The great cosmic mother and the cosmic father were slowly converging, and that's where they, you know, calculated the future 2012 alignment, the galactic alignment. Now there's all these other, God, I could go into all these other discussions about, does the galactic alignment actually have empirical effects from some scientific point of view? Does it really matter? I mean, part of this is really just oriented towards reconstructing what the ancient Maya believed. You know, we don't have to prove that this has some kind of astrophysical effect. It might, I don't know, but that's not sort of like the key to the reconstruction work, you know. But maybe there is something going on here that our own science has not noticed. I mean, it sort of makes sense that as above, so below principle, not so much an argument for astrology, like some kind of empirical astrology, but that everything is interrelated. Everything is interconnected. And at the very least, it's strange to consider that the thing that the Maya expected to be happening on the planet when this alignment was culminating in regards to this crisis around this archetype of greedy, you know, short-term profit motive and self-interest and so on, you know, the challenge being that we have to like reorient things and put things back into right relationship so that we can open up to or awaken to this larger unity consciousness or perspective in which these difficulties in the world can be reconciled and healed. It's kind of like what that symbolizes is how in the creation myth, the hero twins succeeded in sacrificing seven macaw, the archetype of egoism, and then they restore their father's head to his body. You see, their father, Wanhunapu, his head had been cut off by the Dark Lords. That's the whole goal of the creation myth, is the restoration of the unity, the remembering or awakening to that sense of unity consciousness or oneness consciousness, which is sort of like symbolic of the awakening to that higher perspective that is necessary in order to heal the problems of the world. And it's also symbolized beautifully on this monument here. I like this one a lot. Here is the father of the hero twins being reborn from the mouth of the toad, the Milky Way toad. So this, you know, as I mentioned earlier, the mouth of the toad or the jaguar or the snake is symbolic of the dark rift in the Milky Way, that feature that's right there in the galactic center. And he's the December solstice sun deity. And so this is basically a picture of the December solstice sun aligned with the dark rift in the Milky Way. It's kind of like the way that the pyramid of Kukulkan at Chichen Itza, the iconography points to only one possible time frame within the cycle of the precession of the equinoxes, the 21st century for the sun, Pleiades, and the zenith alignment. Here we see a picture that if you know the iconography, I'm not just making it up, I mean the interpretations of the iconography come from the scholars to a large extent. And so this is a picture of an alignment that happens only in the years around 2012. Now going back to the sort of the mystical teachings or the spiritual teachings associated with this, we can look at the throne and the other two little monuments that were found by the throne, which is the game ball and the goal ring and this little serpent head with a little sun ball in its mouth. I interpret this as a really coherent three-part statement, which I take to be the prophecy for 2012 by the people who invented the 2012 calendar. And it should be said that these monuments were found in situ as they were left some 1,800 years ago. So they weren't disturbed or moved around for the most part. It was almost like it was a sacred site that the Maya just abandoned. They didn't mess with it. You know, it was like a sacred thing that they didn't disturb. So anyway, we have the birth and renewal symbolism of the throne. And then we have the little sharp teeth on this little serpent head with a little sun ball in its mouth. I take this to be sort of like the sacrifice transformation idea. You know, something needs to be devoured and transformed for the renewal to happen. Now the key thing here that I haven't really talked about a lot yet is the ball game. This is all happening in the ball court. The creation myth happens in the ball court. It's the ball game being played out. I think that means that we are indispensable participants in this process. We are the ones who are kicking the game ball into the goal ring. And the game ball is the December solstice sun shifting into alignment with the dark rift in the Milky Way as the goal ring. It's a metaphor. The ball game is a metaphor for the galactic alignment convergence, and we are the ones who are doing it. It empowers us to be the participants. You know, this is very important because a lot of the sort of discussion around 2012 is what's going to happen? You know, as if there's some kind of predetermined definite thing, you know, like, and we're just sort of like robots or something, just, you know, waiting around for stuff to happen to us or something. No, we are the ones, you know, who make it or break it in a sense, you know. In other words, we have to engage the process of transformation in our own sort of spiritual awakening or our relationship with the ceremony that we do or opening up. I think everybody here is much more enlightened as to those processes than most audiences I've spoken to, so I don't need to go over and over and over with that, but I think that's the important thing, that we are indispensable participants in these processes of our own awakening. So the spiritual teachings, it is about this dynamic between these two types of consciousness, the limited ego consciousness versus the awakened higher consciousness of the divine self. These are essential Maya spiritual teachings for cycle endings. And what I've found is that this really plugs very nicely into this global perennial philosophy that's been talked about by progressive philosophers for a long time, like Aldous Huxley and Ananda Kumaraswamy, Kathleen Rain, a great Blake scholar, Alan Watts, of course, you know, who's turned on a lot of people to these things. So there's some very profound, the important thing here is that, you know, we have still in our culture and in our media this very denigrating attitude towards the Maya. They're constantly being portrayed as primitive atavistic savages tearing hearts out. No. I will say that, like, any complex civilization will have the full spectrum of human behaviors going on inside of it at any given time, right? We see this. It's obvious, you know. Somebody's being murdered five towns over right now, and somebody's like having a vision of God, you know, three towns over the other direction. You know, it's like, it's a complex civilization phenomenon, you know. So yeah, you had barbarities happening in the Maya world, but let's try to resonate with and plug into these subtler, you know, sort of higher pursuits that the Maya were engaged in. So their tradition is basically congruent with these perennial philosophy teachings, the primordial wisdom that you see at the root, at the archetypal root of all of the world's great religious traditions. Okay, so another thing here that I want to point out, I'll actually go into this in more detail in the 5 o'clock talk, but I was astounded to discover that near Azapa, they've built this monument park, and I've been doing events at Azapa for quite a while now. I did talk to the university there 6 years ago and stuff like that. So I'm sort of a local celebrity there in a sense, and I've done a lot of projects and with the local people. And anyway, they built this huge monument park, and they're basically using the galactic alignment theory with the game ball and the goal ring, and they lined it up perfectly with the rising December solstice sun. So they consciously did this. The architect for this is a guy that's read my books, a really, really interesting architect, artist, and he worked with the state of Chiapas, which funded this project to the tune of $1 million, to incorporate the symbolism of the ball game with the alignment that I've reconstructed at Azapa. So if you're standing right here in front of the creation text, you look off in that direction with the game ball and the goal ring, and the December solstice sun is rising right there through the goal ring. Pretty cool. Unfortunately, it's kind of one of those phenomenons where it's a little disturbing. Like I think they could have mentioned me in the literature around that or something, but maybe they're still working on that. That happens a lot. It's funny how you see your ideas sort of get integrated around places, but it's cool though. I mean, it's really it's like an honor. It's really an honor, you know, to see that happen. So the fire ceremony is really the way that the Maya shamans communicate with different domains. And just to sort of wrap this up, where are we at on time right now? Okay. I'm right on time, of course. No, the Maya Conservancy is this nonprofit organization that I've been involved in. We work with the traditional spiritual guides, they call themselves. They don't really like the term elders so much. I still revert to day keepers. That's kind of a classic sort of term. But they're ceremonialists, and they still count the days. And they are engaged in that ritual process of doing ceremony at certain days in the calendar. A lot of times it's a little period ending in the calendar. So they know that period endings are about the ceremonial process of facilitating transformation and renewal. So it's no surprise to them that 2012 would be thought of as a time of transformation and renewal, not some doomsday thing. In fact, a lot of the documentaries that are coming out now, like 2012 The Beginning, I'll have a clip of that on the 5 o'clock talk, is that we talk to the Maya and we ask them about it, and they don't get this whole doomsday thing, you know. So anyway, Tach Rigoberto Itzep Chanchavac, a traditional Quiche Maya spiritual guide, and his son on the left and his wife on the right, oftentimes husbands and wives work together. It's a very male-female sort of oriented thing. In fact, the highest initiatory level in the daykeeper tradition, there's like 5 levels. And on December 12th, there's going to be ceremony taking place at the traditional shrine sites in Guatemala. And there's 5 levels of initiation for the daykeepers. The highest level is called the Mother Father. And we worked with these amazing people, Tach Rigoberto and his associates, back 2 years ago. We brought them around to 5 different sites. We did ceremony. We had, you know, a ceremonial process with the fire takes place. It's like 3-4 hours. And it is a real transformative thing when you go through it and participate in it. Very wonderful people to work with. And in fact, I didn't go into this in great detail, but you know, that first trip that I took to Central America back in 86, 87, I fell in love with Maya culture, Maya people, and I returned every year and did service work. And so it was very, very moving for me to be working with my Maya friends here in the fire ceremony. Back in 94, I delivered relief supplies and did some work at the Shrine of Paclón. And so the fire ceremony is really an important ritual process. It helps create community. It's opening up a sacred space. I think that's a very important ritual thing, is to create that vibration. I think that's what is going on here at the gathering here, is that there's a vibration that can be created and fed to open up a sacred space so that you know, renewal can happen. This is at the site of Takalik Abak, our group there. Really, really cool process. And then we got to Azapa. See, the whole point of this trip 2 years ago was to get to Azapa and do the reopening of the site of Azapa, because Azapa's in Mexico, and the Mexican government doesn't let rituals take place. In Guatemala, they do. In fact, they put altars around, so it's okay. But it was a very tricky thing, but we were able to pull it off, and so we were very happy to facilitate this ritualistic reopening of this important site in the Maya world. Now, we were surprised that we were invited by the Tapachula Town Council to come, and Tach Rigoberto was invited to speak, and he said, "Let's remember the wisdom that comes from our ancestors. Their wisdom was so profound. We cannot project ourselves into the future if we do not look back into the root. The future is our past. We cannot deny any of the 3 phases of past, present, and future. We have the privilege of having this time now to revive and adapt the ancient and ongoing sacred ceremony." Now, just this year, we did it again. And we brought in Roberto Paz and his daughter Ishquik, who was named after the mother of the Hero twins. And she too said something very brilliant about the interdependence of all things and how we need to be working together as a community in this time of renewal to plant seeds of peace. And I think that's an important thing for us all to remember and meditate on. So thank you so much for your time. And thank you.